Thank you very much, Peter, for the very kind introduction, and thank you everybody in the audience. We would like to thank the organizers on behalf of the team at Search for allowing us to present our study to you here today, because basically HIV cure and acute HIV infection is the focus of our work at Search. And as you can see here in the outline, I really want to start with acute infection. I think there is maybe more going on in the field of cure research. It's not all good news, but there's more news. But it has less direct impact on clinical care. And I had to make a guess, and I think we are here in an audience of clinicians, nurses. So I figured I should focus more on acute infection than cure today, simply because it has more direct impact on your day-to-day work. Then a disclaimer, I work only with adults. There's the immune system of children, and particularly infants, is very different from adults. So basically, one day, Dr. Tanya, we will provide a beautiful talk on those aspects of cure research, but that will not be included in today's presentation. So basically, why do we consider acute HIV infection important? It's when it all starts. It's basically when that massive CD4 depletion in the body starts, and particularly in the gut. It really starts there very early and very dramatically. The immune system exhaustion is starting. HIV starts to mutate and escape the immune system. And there is a highly increased chance of transmission because viral loads are very high. And there's also some publications that suggest that founder viruses, the viruses that establish infection, are founder viruses for a reason and are also more easily transmitted. Then what do we consider acute infection? Really, acute infection is any infection before the Western blot is fully positive. So that last stage is before the P31 becomes positive. But in our study and in many places, we like to think a little bit earlier, like the first 4 to 6 weeks after HIV infection. That's about through FIBIC stage 4. In the figure at the bottom. Then this slide is outdated, but I left it there for a reason. And this is an acute retroviral syndrome slide that Dr. Jean Tenaat presented in the past based on her article in PLOS ONE. We recently published an update in the Clinical Infectious Diseases, and the overall percentage of symptoms has actually decreased one. Now we have higher numbers of subjects in our study. At the time, we reported that 87% of people would present with enteroretroviral syndrome to us. It's now about 78%, but fever is still the highest ranking symptom. And why I left it in there is because, as you can see, does this work? No. At the bottom it says, almost all sought care elsewhere, but none was offered HIV testing. And the good news is, that's no longer true. We see a substantial number of people who are actually referred to us by other facilities in Thailand, and primarily Bangkok, who get worked up for dengue, influenza, maybe have an indeterminate test, a doctor with a high suspicion. So we see far more subjects who get referred. And we also see a substantial number of self-referrals. We see people who go to other clinics for a workup for influenza, dengue, get sent home with viral syndrome, and then immediately come to the anonymous clinic for testing. So I think that's a very big that also, I think, plays a big part in why we recruit 100 subjects per year right now versus 30 in the early years. So that's an interesting development, and that's something we all can contribute to. If we believe that it's worthwhile treating acute infection, it's simply still true that we should have a very high level of suspicion. So then where does HIV replicate and hide once it's in the body? You all may know that HIV has a tendency to go into the CD4 cells. Some of the CD4 memory cells become latently infected. So rather than go on as actively virus-producing cells and that will then produce virions that infect other cells, some of these cells go to sleep. And that is the big problem. Those latently infected cells look like any other resting memory cell. They have nothing on the outside that suggests to the immune system they're infected, and they're called the latent reservoir. And as far as we know, it's particularly prevalent in the lymph nodes, the brain, also in the genital tract, and then, of course, in the lymphatic system of the gut as well. Our study, SEARCH-10 RV254, is a study that was set up particularly to study acute HIV infection. It was started in 2009 with the support of Achan Prapan, Dr. Jean Tenaat, Jerome Kim, and they started screening everybody who gets tested at the anonymous clinic. And people who test HIV negative have a sample pooled at night with other people for nuclear acid testing. So that's a test that will detect viral RNA approximately 1 week before the fourth generation EIA becomes positive. And people who test positive or have an inconclusive test, they get tested with a cascade of IAs. So basically they go through a third generation test, a fourth generation test, a second generation test. If the second generation test, which tests for IgM and IgG, if that one is still negative, we also consider them acutely infected. By doing that, we've been able to identify over 600 acute infections. Only 522 of those agree to enroll in our study, and they get immediate ART. That entire process takes 2 to 3 days. So it's really a 24/7 operation, and we're very lucky with the high enrollment. Then the cohort in Bangkok is predominantly male, mostly MSM, 26 years old median age, 81% are infected with the most common subtype in Thailand, CRF01AE. We find them about 19 days after infection. That's behavioral database, so that's always, of course, an estimated guess. Most of them we find in FEBIC 3, so say 2 to 4 weeks after infection. Some we find in FEBIC 1, 73 of them. The vast majority is very well virologically controlled. We have frequent follow-up. We have a wonderful nursing team, so I think that's largely to the credit of the nursing team. And then what has helped us tremendously in Thailand to make this a worthwhile cohort is that a lot of our volunteers agree to invasive procedures. We have a lot of people who agree to donate a lymph node, get a spinal tap, do leukapheresis, provide sigmoid biopsy. And those samples really go all over the world. They go to the US, they go to Europe, they are examined here in Thailand as well by collaborators. And we work with 24 collaborating institutions where the samples are used. So that's a very good use of study samples. So we're very happy with that. Then what this study showed very early on, this is based on only the first 150 subjects, is that if you give these people ART, as expected, the viral load, the HIV RNA in the blood comes down very rapidly. This is a comparison between 3 and 5 drugs. It goes a bit steeper if you give them 5 drugs, but really by week 16 to 20, everybody has an undetectable viral load. No surprises there, we knew that. But what we now know because of Nicolas Chaumont in Montreal, who looks at that latent reservoir for us, and he does that by looking at the total HIV DNA, so not RNA, in PBMCs after these people have been treated with ART. What you then see is that the DNA in these people can also be tremendously minimized. If you look at the top line, the red line, those are chronically infected people that started ART. And in 2 years of ART, their HIV DNA in the PBMCs comes down, but minimally. And to bring it down substantially, they need decades of ART. Then if you look at the purple line, those are FEBIC 2 to 4 subjects, the first observation is that even though they've been just infected, their DNA, when we meet them, is already nearly as high as in the chronics. But at the same time, when we start them right then and there, before their immune system and they are further affected, we can bring down that HIV DNA in 2 years' time to very low levels. Then the FEBIC ones, the blue line at the bottom, are the biggest exception. They are people that are really early in infection. They don't even have that much HIV DNA to start with yet. And even they get a reduction in that minimal amount of DNA when you start them on ART. This slide looks complex, and it's basically showing the same thing, but then not just for blood, for PBMCs, but that it's also happening in the lymph node, in the sigmoid colon, in those places where the HIV DNA, where the latent reservoir is present. Okay, then this slide, I'll skip for sake of time, but basically it shows that also inducible virus is greatly reduced. Then we are lucky to work with a lot of good collaborators. So what we also showed over time is with Serena Sputnik from Yale and Victor Velkor at UCSF, that the virus is present in CSF really from the get-go, so there is not really any delay. The viral load in the spinal fluid is less than in the blood, but it's there from the start. But, the good thing then again, these are immunological markers. If you start treating right away, you can reach very good results. These are just two markers of inflammation in the CSF, And in particular, if you look at the IP10 here on the right, this is the, so basically an HIV negative individual would have no inflammation to speak of. A chronically infected person is here that has no ART. That chronically infected person, when he or she starts ART, will reach this level of inflammation, so it will be reduced dramatically, but it's significant. If you start an early infection, you only start here and you can become near normal. So there's a lot of parameters that we can bring down in these acutes to resemble more HIV negatives than we ever could achieve in chronically infected subjects. This is a slide of lymph nodes provided by Tim Schecker, who will provide much more on this at CROI. And we have a lot of data at CROI this year, and CROI is wonderful in that it has the same thing we have here this year, is that it's very web accessible. So any of you interested in this subject, there's a lot of data on these things at CROI, which can all be accessed online as presentations, as posters. And this is to your left here is the lymph node of an HIV negative type person that is representative of a group. These we didn't look just at individuals. And the average HIV negative type person in Tim Schecker's lab has that purple stuff is 9.8% collagen deposition in the lymph node. That's kind of fibrosis. If you then look at a person who started HIV treatment in FIBIG1, who took ART for 1 to 2 years, they have about 13.3% fibrosis in their lymph nodes. That's already an increase, but it's limited. If you start in FIBIG 3 or 4 with your ART, then you have about a quarter of your lymph node fibrosed, even if you take 2 years of ART. So the interesting thing with all these things is that we know when we give chronically infected people ART, they do very well. So is there any benefit in knowing all this? Is there any need to do anything about all this? And of course, I'm very prejudiced because I work in this field and I see these data all the time. And it's like, if it were me, I would rather have this lymph node than that one. Even though you tell me that on ART, my life expectancy is very good. It's somehow, it seems reassuring to resemble more an HIV negative person than to be at this spectrum. So I think it's still very worthwhile to catch people early, to treat early, and to preserve as much normality in terms of immunity as we can. Another slide showing the same thing, this time in the gut. This is from Dr. Alex Schütz at EFRIMS here in Bangkok. And what you see is that if you look at CD4 T cells in the sigmoid mucosa, this is what the level that people have who are HIV negative, the percent of CD4 T cells in the mucosa. This is chronically infected people on ART here, that green line. If you start treating at FIBIG1, you stay very close to normal. If you start treating at FIBIG3, you will never be close to normal again. What we also found, and this has real implications for the clinic, and I have no quick fix for you, is that if you start treating very early, you start treating people who do not have a positive antibody test yet. This shows, the red bar, is people who are diagnosed in FIBIG1, which means that they only have detectable HIV RNA. They don't even have P24 antigen yet. And we start treating them. So per definition, at baseline, the majority was not reactive on the four-generation test. But what you see is when we treat them, the majority never becomes HIV positive on the four-generation test. And we now have data out to week 48 and in much larger numbers also to be presented at CROI. And this trend continues. And I think that's a problem for the treatment programs in many of our countries, which ask us to document that people are infected to be eligible for treatment. They want data from us that you may never be able to provide. Would we deny these people treatment? The Thai treatment guidelines say that if people are infected, regardless of viral load and CD4 count, they may be treated. And I would want to be treated if I was here. So we're going to have more complexities, I think, in HIV testing as people are detected earlier. This also ties into the fact that we have started treatment in some people who were on PEP or PrEP. So they had a negative HIV test, a negative four-generation test, when they started their PrEP or PEP. And then with the NET testing, we did find them to be HIV positive. And we start treating these people at very low viral load levels. And there are many clinicians who will still question whether these could be false positive. And Dr. Don Colby in our group, who's sitting in the audience, has done a very nice inventory to document as good as possible that we believe none of these people are false positive and why we think so. And that's also going to be a presentation at CROI. But our take currently is that if you have somebody with a positive viral load, with a confirmed HIV RNA, whether that's a NET test or another quantitative viral load, we haven't found anybody yet with two positive tests that turned out to be negative in the end. Okay, then what was most exciting for me personally this year is that we were able to publish this article. This is a modeling study with David Wilson from Burnet Institute in Sydney. And based on our data, he was able to help us model that by detecting our volunteers very early and by the behavioral change these people display after hearing their diagnosis and knowing that they're HIV positive, and by having viral load reductions because of the early ART, the estimate is that we reduce onward transmissions from this cohort, from these 522 people, by 89%. That's dramatic. And then if you know that some studies estimate that acute infection may be responsible for 50% of transmissions in some epidemics, for example, in Bangkok MSM, nobody knows the real number, but the estimate is that it's a high contributing factor to transmission, then it's very exciting if you can reduce it by 89%. If you, this is, I think, next to PrEP, one of the best things you can do to curtail the infection. Then going on to cure, and let me check how much time I have. Okay, that's going well. Okay, so cure definitions. I think when most of us think of a cure, we think of a sterilizing cure, basically eradicating the virus from the body completely. At this point, we started there with that ambition. I think we still have that ambition in the end, but right now people are really studying functional cure or remission, where basically we know that there is still virus present in the body, but it's limited, and people are able to control it themselves without ARV. So truly a remission. That's the best we hope to achieve right now before we move on to sterilizing cure. Okay, then do we believe it's possible? We have proof of concept, right? We do know from the Berlin patient here at the bottom who got a bone marrow transplant with basically HIV-resistant bone marrow that he is cured. He shows no sign of any HIV in his body or a recurrence of HIV. And then there's been these cases that have been well described in the literature, like the Boston patients, the Mississippi baby, the Spartak and Visconti patients, who all in different ways either had a delayed viral load rebound or they maintained control of their virus without any ART. So, and these people, for example, the Visconti people, these are not elite controllers. These are people that were early treated and then stopped ART. So there's something about early treatment that helps some people control the virus. So then what are the barriers to a cure? They haven't changed. It's that HIV persistence in the tissues, the latently infected cells, and the fact that these cells are not just all resting memory cells, but are actually quite diverse. Then what do we do to eradicate it? Strategies that should reach the tissues, that should be specific, and that should target all cells. So then basically, what do? We give ART in chronics and in acutes, that's the same. That's what we're doing in study SEARCH 10 already. We reduce the HIV RNA in the DNA. And then the possible interventions really in the basics also haven't changed since you've last heard about cure. What is available is either latency reversing agents, which is basically having those resting cells wake up, make sure the immune system sees them, and then hope the immune system will wipe them out. It is antibodies. Where's my arrow going here? Antibodies. So basically, broadly neutralizing antibodies were the first that are very HIV specific. Broadly neutralizing antibodies are actually made by 20% of people with HIV infection, about 20%. They are very effective antibodies. They just come too late. They come after 2 to 5 years of infection, when the virus is so highly diverse in that individual that even those wonderful antibodies are not enough. If you could use those antibodies in somebody who doesn't have that diversity, like our patients who are very early treated, could they do something? So that's still ongoing. Then there's therapeutic vaccines, helping the immune system combat the virus and wipe out the latently infected cells. And then gene editing therapy, which hasn't been done in our part of the world yet, and which I'm not going to touch upon further today because I think it's the hardest one to scale up if it would come to fruition. So shock and kill, we've done really studies with all three concepts. The big thing to mention is that every study we did tested a single concept, as it should be. We don't know anything yet, so we started from scratch, and we've tested the latency reversal. We've tested an antibody. We are testing a vaccine. So with the shock and kill therapy, we did a study with a latency reversing agent called vorinostat. I won't go into the details of the study here, but all the studies we did into cure thus far are in small groups of patients, because the issue is that to prove whether you delay viral rebound, you're going to have to stop ART. And since stopping ART comes with risks, you don't want to expose more people than necessary. So all the studies we've done are in small groups of people. We start ART again if the virus reaches 1,000 copies per ml, so that's well below where most people were when we first diagnosed them, and then we hope for the best. We've done this study with vorinostat, and it did not work. Basically, within the first 6 weeks, 7 weeks, nearly everybody had viral rebound, and then there's one exception, which is a lady who actually did not receive the active treatment. The median time to viral load detection was 22 days. Study RV397 was a study with a broadly neutralizing antibody. Similar, a small study. People received broadly neutralizing antibody infusions and had their ART interrupted, and the outcome was largely the same. Viral rebound, albeit somewhat delayed. It seems to be doing something. What you see here is that for people to reach that 1,000 copies and to restart their ART, took longer in the people who received the VRC01 than people who received the placebo. And then there was the one big exception, a young man who took 44 weeks to rebound. His samples are now, I think, the subject of much study at our collaborator labs, because this gentleman had nothing going for him relatively. He was, all these people, of course, have a very low DNA reservoir, but this young man actually had the highest HIV DNA count before he entered the study. His CD4-CD8 ratio was not good, and he had no protective genes. Yet he lasted the longest. So the interaction between his immune system and virus and the VRC01 is heavily studied right now. Then we're doing a study with therapeutic vaccines right now. It's a combination of two vaccines, and people are stopping treatment as we sit here today. The interruption is ongoing, but I don't have data on that yet. And then the study from which we learned the most is actually this one, which is study RV411. It's a study in only 8 subjects. They were enrolled in FEBIC1, and they the only thing we did is stop therapy. We decided these people are the ones that started ART the earliest. Can they control without any further measures? Do you need to boost them with any interventions? There was hope that some of these people could control. The target was to have one of these 8 people control the virus for at least 12 weeks, and then we would enroll more subjects, and we did not enroll more subjects. They all rebounded as well. The median time to rebound was 26 days. So that is all in and of itself not particularly positive, but there are interesting findings, and it's clearly not the end of the road, because even though the numbers are very small, what we are able to show already is that the FEBIC ones did last the longest. So there is something to be said for starting early and having that reservoir, having your immunity intact and having a very small reservoir. They rebounded the slowest compared to the FEBIC 3 and 4, and they rebounded decidedly slower than the chronically infected subjects that have been stopped in historical trials. Then also the viral load, once it returns at a slower pace in the FEBIC ones and the people that started treatment very early. This is a complex slide, but what is just interesting about it is what has been a question of much debate is, if you start treatment too early, do you prevent people from developing some sort of immune response that could be protective? And while the definitive answer is not out, what has been very interesting is that this is these people, when we first enrolled them in Study Search 10, before they started ART, and there was no significant HIV CD8 response detectable. However, once these people have been on ART, we take them off, and then they have viral rebound, they have a very rapidly expanding HIV-specific CD8 T-cell response. So even though they were treated very, very early, there was already clearly something going on before we started at ART or at that time, and they're also able to recall, to tap into that very rapidly when you stop the ART and the virus recurs. The thing that is good for this research to go forward is that while we've only stopped therapy in 40 subjects, in those 40 people it's been safe. Here you see the phobic ones in study RV411. This is their HIV DNA before they started ART, very early on. Then they were on ART. When we did the study, we stopped the ART, their virus comes back up, and we never let it go too far, so we start the ART again. And what you see is that the HIV DNA, that reservoir, comes down again, and it comes down back to the level they were before. So we don't seem to be creating a bigger reservoir. What we also did not do, and this is a phylogenetic slide, but it's just as an illustration, we did not see any new genotypic resistance mutations in any of the people in whom we stopped ART. This is 40 people, so I cannot promise you it will never happen. But it seems that if you do it carefully enough and you restart ART soon enough, that chance should at least be small. Dr. Sotsai then at MHRP in the US, she looked at the sequences of these people, and what she saw is that there are similar sequences between the acute infection and after rebound, suggesting lack of viral replication during the therapy and possibly clonal expansion of latently infected cells. Basically, these are the same viruses. So we have not created resistance as yet by stopping the ART. Then also nobody had serious adverse events related to the interruption, only to the intervention we provided, to the vorinostat. And also everybody goes back to undetectable viral load very rapidly when we start ART again. So then what's next? What's the way forward if these single interventions don't look good? We know that HIV remission is uncommon in early treated people, but it's not completely unheard of. So basically, this is maybe the way to go. The slide here on your left is a monkey slide. This is a human slide. And these are groups that are doing studies not with a single intervention like we did, but with a combination of interventions. So here on the left, you see the monkeys got Ad26 MVA vaccine, so therapeutic vaccine, with a toll-like receptor agonist, which is comparable in some ways into a latency-reversing agent. And what you then see is that the monkeys, the red line, are the monkeys who received both. They do get viral rebound, but then start to exert a significant level of viral control and get very low viral load levels. This was less impressive, but not absent in a human study. This is a study from Barcelona that was presented at CROI this year, where people also received a combination of therapeutic vaccines, chimp adeno with MVA, and romidepsin, a latency reversing agent. And 5 out of 13 people who received the combination at 24 weeks after stopping ART had some control of their viremia. So this looks much better than what I showed you earlier, what we did here in Thailand. And that basically ties into the belief of many of the scientists in this field that just like you need combination antiretroviral therapy, you need combination therapy to ever achieve viral remission. So you need both maybe those antibodies and the therapeutic vaccine, or you need the latency reversal and the antibody and the vaccine altogether. But this is happening right now. This is one of the first human trials employing a combination, but they're clearly in the making. Now we know that these interventions are relatively safe and the combinations are happening. Then basically this, I can skip this. This is something people may have heard about. This is vedolizumab. These are monkey data as well. The first human study with vedolizumab is taking place at the NIH. None of us know what it's showing, so that's it. But that's going to be very exciting to find out more about. These were monkeys that were treating with an antibody that is given to people with colitis. And after they received it, they received that together with ART. They started their ART about 5 weeks after infection. And the blue line here at the bottom are the monkeys who received the vedolizumab. The red ones are the monkeys who received control IgG. The control IgG monkeys on ART, when you stop the ART, this is the ART period, the virus came right back. The monkeys who received the vedolizumab, the virus also came back, but then it made a U-turn, and all the monkeys received viral control. Whether this can be repeated in humans, there's a lot of questions about this study. Nobody really understands the mechanism fully, but at the NIH, the first human studies are taking place, and they're now enrolling people who were acutely infected as well. So we very much look forward to these data in this field. Then this is my last slide that I'll show. Basically, what we need is to bring that latent virus down and get our immunity to control the virus. And that's likely this part is going to take more than a single intervention. And then I have a few more slides that I'll skip for the benefit of time. And I would like to thank you very much for your attention.